Good morning, friends. I must at the outset confess that I have nothing original to present to you. Whatever I speak is what I learned from great master. All the credit for anything that happens to anyone goes to great master. If something does not happen right, then that infirmity is mine and I take responsibility for that. But all good things that you speak about really belong to great master. I am really like a parrot. The parrot doesn't use his own sense to speak, he just repeats what he's told to do. I'm like that parrot of the great master. Having said that, I'd like to remind you that being on the spiritual path does not mean to take a decision to sit at home and say, I am living in the will of the master, things will happen by themselves. That was never the teaching of the great master. The great master referred to the threefold path of yoga, which had been brought out in the Gita by Lord Krishna speaking to Arjun on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Krishna tells Arjun that there are three forms of yoga. Yoga is union with the Supreme Self. Yoga is to realize your own self. Yoga is to become one with God, the Creator. Yoga is union with the ultimate. To achieve that, you can follow three paths. The first is the path of karma yoga, which means the path of action. Karma yoga is when you act skillfully to the best of your capacity, best of circumstances. Yoga karma so kaushalam, the Gita says that is true yoga where you apply your best skills in your action, but then follow it up by expecting no reward for your actions. Leave the rewards to God, the Creator, your higher self. But your actions, being trapped in this world where you feel you have free will, having been trapped, use that opportunity, even of the trap, even of the illusion of free will, use that opportunity of this illusion to put in the very best foot forward in performing your role on this stage of creation. If an actor does not act well his part, he spoils the whole show. It does not mean that the actor is really what he's acting. His reality may be different. Supposing there is a street barber. We have in India barbers who, you know, they sharpen their knives and they give you a shave and cut your hair. Supposing one day there's a village drama going on. A show comes into the village and he's picked up to play the role of a king. And he sits on the throne like a king. But every time he speaks, he says, I am the king. And does like this, sharpening his knife. He's spoiling the play. He's supposed to be acting like the king, although he's a barber. In the same way, although our reality, our truth, is not only a spiritual immortal soul, it is a non-individualized, single consciousness, the total consciousness which we call the Creator. That is our reality. But that should not deflect us from performing a role in a local drama on the physical plane where we have been assigned different roles according to our circumstances. Therefore, a person on the spiritual path must follow the rule of karma yoga. That means perform your actions according to circumstances to the very best of your ability. If you are a true satsangi, a true follower of a perfect living master, you will do the very best in whatever circumstance you are placed. Therefore, if somebody has got a wrong message, I am a follower of his will, I live in his will, therefore I am going to hide and sit and wait for him to do what he wants. Such a person is not living in the will of the Creator. Because the Creator is inside that person. The Creator did not say, don't do anything. So he set up circumstances to do something. Maulana Rum, one of the Sufi mystics, was asked this question. How do we know what is his will? Every day people say, live in God's will. How do we know what is His will? He said, that is such a simple question. You want to know what His will is? If He has placed a spade in your hand, He has expressed His will, dig. If He has put a pen in your hand, He has expressed His will, write. If He has put you before a classroom, He has expressed His will, teach. If He has expressed His will by putting you into a farm, He has said, farm, be a good farmer. Whatever circumstances have been created by your destiny and by this show around you, His will is to perform to the best of your ability with extraordinary skill. The best skill that you can muster, physical, emotional, mental, spiritual, all the skills put together, do your very best. Then you are living in His will. Karma Yoga requires that. Lord Krishna tells Arjun, the second yoga is Jnana Yoga or Sankhya Yoga, which means the yoga of knowledge, the intellectual process that goes in our head. We have never been able to stop that. Some people think it's very simple. I don't want to live by my mind. I want to live by my spirit. And they're saying this with the mind. I want to understand what my intuition is. And they're constantly using the mind to understand intuition. These are two different things. How can you mix up a mental intellectual activity with something that is beyond the mind? It cannot be done. Therefore, Krishna tells Arjuna, if you want to practice Sankhya Yoga, which you should if you are a follower of truth, if you are a follower of the path, then you must use this intellectual contemplation to the best of your ability to see the limits up to which it can go. Do not stop short. Say, no, I don't want to think. I don't want to think about these things. I don't want to use my mind. Have you found anybody ever who has not used the mind? I haven't. I find people are talking about not using the mind the most in talking about it. And they cannot escape. The mind is one factor in our consciousness that never stops. It does not stop while we are awake. It does not stop while we are sleeping. It is constantly in motion, constantly active. We never stop thinking. I gave you, some of you might have heard the example of a friend of mine right here in Cambridge, when I was at Harvard. He claimed, this is not the same story I told last night. So don't get worried about being excessively bored. Of course, some of you have heard it, but not all. He claimed that he had learned a technique through yogic exercises, through certain sadhana, certain methods, how to stop the mind. And that amazed me, because I was always claiming that the mind is an automatic process. When it stops, we die. Not only we die, the mind dies, the causal body dies, the astral body dies, the physical body dies. It's a big event for the mind to stop. So mind never stops. He said he had found out how to stop thinking. That was a great thing. So I said, come along to my apartment. We'll conduct an experiment. No tea, coffee, and empty cup. I said, come on, we'll conduct an experiment in which we'll see what happens to a wakeful person with a living consciousness and awareness, knowing what's going on. What happens to that consciousness when the mind does not think? That'll be great advancement in spiritual knowledge for the whole world. So he came over to my apartment in the evening and we set up the experiment in a very simple way. The experiment was that at 9 o'clock, I should give him a signal to stop thinking. The signal was I'll clap like this. When I clap, he should stop thinking. And I'll wait for 60 seconds. He said I can do it for half an hour. I said 1 minute is enough. If one can stop thinking for 1 minute, I'll believe he can stop thinking for 30 minutes also. So I said, let's conduct the experiment only for 60 seconds. When I clap, I look at my watch, see the second hand going. When 1 minute is completed, I'll give the second clap. Then he can start thinking again. Then we will sit together and review what happened in those 60 seconds. It'll be great knowledge, addition to knowledge. What happens to human awareness when one does not think? He came, he got into his yogic asanas. He crossed his legs, put his hands in different positions. He took up his face in a certain way. Whatever he had learnt, he did all that to be prepared to stop thinking, to shut off his mind, as it were. I was not bothered with what he was doing. I was watching for 9 o'clock. At 9 o'clock, I gave the signal. And I watched him in repose. He was obviously in some kind of a trance. He looked like he had done something, he had learned something, which was very tranquil on his face, in his body, he was still. After 60 seconds, I gave the second clap. And he woke up. And he said, yes, I was able to do what you wanted. I said, great. The real experiment starts now when we review what happened in 60 seconds of non-thinking. I said, I'll just ask a few questions to understand what happens. First question is that when I clapped at 9 o'clock, how did you know? After the clap, how did you know this was the time to stop thinking? Go back into memory, because it just happened now. Just happened a few minutes ago. Go back into memory and see what happened. And he said, yeah, I recall. Just when you clapped, I said to myself, this is the time to stop thinking. I said, did you say these words in your mind? I said, yes, I did. I said, that's like a thought. It's not like a thought, it is a thought. Your mind was still thinking these words. He said, yes. My experiment failed for a few seconds. A few seconds of thought made an inroad into that 60-second blank period. Let's consider that those seconds should be left out. I agreed. I said, I am willing to consider that the experiment wasn't for 60 seconds, it was for 55 seconds. The first 5 seconds are grace seconds taken off. Now I want to know that in the remaining 55 seconds, how did you know? And now this is not a theoretical question. It is to recall from memory what happened. How did you know after 5 seconds that when I make the second clap, you can resume thinking? How did you know that? If you had stopped thinking, you would never think again. Did something happen to you to remind you that after 55 seconds, you can start thinking again? And he recalled, yes, I said to myself, and I will not start thinking till he claps again. I said, that's another thought. What happened after that? We talked about 10 minutes, and he recalled all that he thought in those 60 seconds. He put his hands on his head. He said, oh my God, I thought more in the 60 seconds than ever before. The experiment failed. What I am trying to tell you is that sometimes it looks like we have stopped thinking. But it does not mean we really stop thinking. We just change our channels of thinking. We think at a certain level and then suddenly we start thinking at another level. I'll give you an example. We are supposed to do meditation by repeating a mantra, repeating some words, simran, repetition of words. This is very common. Most people who meditate use some kind of words to repeat. And it is recommended that you must repeat those words with the mind and not with the tongue. Because if you repeat with the tongue, the mind keeps on thinking other things. People who have practiced repeating the words with the mind, when asked to look back, what were they saying in the head when they were repeating the words, can often recall that while the words were going on, something else was speaking in the head saying, are you going too fast? Is it slow enough? When are we supposed to stop? When are we going to end this meditation? The words are going on, which means there can be two levels of thought. The man who discussed this subject at great length with me was His Holiness the Dalai Lama of Tibet. When he came to Dharamsala, I was assigned the duty by government to look after him. And so we had great opportunities to have discussions on various subjects. At that time, he was a very young Lama, very young Dalai Lama. And he had two tutors who used to teach him meditation. He used to meditate for 8 hours a day. He came up with this question to me. then we were discussing meditation. He came up with this question that it is really not possible to stop the mind from thinking, because when we control the mind by putting controlled thoughts, some other part of the mind picks up and starts commenting upon that. When the second level is controlled, the third level picks up. Now, I have discussed with a lot of people who have done meditation for long periods, and they can go up to 3, 4, 5 levels and discover that the mind never stopped thinking, even though you have controlled various levels, various channels. Dalai Lama was the first person who said he had very carefully gone over it and seen that even the 8th level exists, where the mind is still thinking in a very feeble, thin voice over what is happening in the 7 levels below. I'm telling you, these people who have done meditation have said the mind never stops thinking, even though you control it in various ways. Therefore, Krishna tells Arjuna, this mind will never stop. It is your constant companion. It is such a strong companion of yours. You have virtually identified yourself with the mind. You who were the consciousness, the motive power for the mind to be alive. You were the spirit. You were the soul that made all these things living, made the body, senses, mind, all alive. You have become so subject to the control of this mind that you identify and you do not even think that the mind is a separate machine working for you. You start believing that the mind is yourself. Such a close identification is the cause of all your troubles. Have you ever considered this part? If you stopped identifying yourself with the mind and think the mind is merely a computer, a machine installed in your head to help your consciousness, your whole life will change from that moment at once. It does not take long. So long as you say, I am thinking like this, I think I should do this, I feel I am going to do this, and you are ascribing all the activities of the mind to yourself, you are in trouble. Why are you in trouble by associating with the mind and identifying yourself with the mind? Because the mind, by its very structure, by its very nature, by the very system it has to operate through time and space, through a thought process, by that very structure, is bound to create doubts and fears. There's no way out of it. The mind is not capable of creating certainty. The certainty comes from other activities in consciousness, such as intuition, faith. Those things come from somewhere else, not by thinking hard about these things. People have destroyed their love by thinking. People have destroyed their faith by thinking. People have destroyed their communication with other people by thinking. Yet, if we could use the mind and not identify with the mind, our whole life would be totally different. And our communication with people would be totally different. Therefore, Krishna advocates the Sankhya Yoga, the yoga of knowledge, intellectual knowledge, to be used to exhaust your mind to the point the mind realizes, this is beyond me. When does that happen? When you discover that all the thoughts, all your thoughts combined cannot go beyond, cannot transcend the limits of time and space. There is no way to have any thought that does not require time and space. And yet there are features inside our consciousness like love, intuition, beauty, joy, that do not need time nor space. Therefore, it's a very good suggestion that use your mind to think out its own limits. When the mind, by contemplation, thinks out its own limits and discovers there is something beyond, that's the best contribution the mind can make to your self-realization. Therefore, the Sankhya Yoga, the yoga of intellectual contemplation, also leads to the same result when you discover that this mind is not enough to get anything real. Krishna says, there's a third yoga. Yoga of love and devotion, bhakti yoga. In bhakti yoga, you surrender because you are experiencing love and devotion in a way where you lose your own self and you identify with the beloved. Not with the mind, but with the beloved. Fortunately, we all have had that experience. Believers or non-believers. Some moments in life come when we fall in love with somebody. It's instantaneous. It happens just like that. We don't know. There's no explanation why it happened. And we are hit by that love bug in a way, bitten by that bug in a way we cannot explain. There is no cause for it. There is no time in it. We cannot say how long it took. It does not take 1 second or 2 seconds or 10 minutes. It's instantaneous. It's like intuition, like a hunch. It hits us. And we feel so great. We forget ourselves. The beloved attracts our consciousness and attention in a way unknown to us. No mental contemplation has ever given that. We have all had that at some point in our life. Sometimes more than once. Sometimes 10 times. Certainly at least once we've all had, because it is natural to us to have it. Then what happens? When we have that, the mind intervenes immediately. Start thinking about what happened. Oh, can that be real? Is it true? Can you believe it? Can you trust it? And we destroy that experience. The experience of love is natural to us. So long as we are spiritual consciousness, it is natural to us. But the mind helps us to destroy it. This particular love, where we forget ourselves, is the only love that can control our ego. The mental ego, which separates us from others. The I-ness, which says, I have this, you have that. I am separate from you. I am even separate from God, who is sitting inside me. This separation that is being created by that part of consciousness we call the ego, the I-ness, the mindness, this me-ness, this I, me, mine, that ego which separates us from everything else, everybody else, including our own self, it separates. This ego is so strong in us that every pursuit we make in this world is through this ego. We want to achieve something in this world, we use this ego. We want to succeed, we want this ego. We want to smash our ego, we use our ego. Somebody tells, be humble. He says, I am going to practice some humility. I am now very humble. This ego never goes. Even in practicing its own destruction, it rises with force. Because this I am doing it. I am going to be humble. I am going to be nothing. I am going to efface myself. I have lived in the will of the Lord. I alone now live in the will of the Lord. The I is living more than the Lord. This I never seems to die. This mental ego. If you ever seen this whole world, look at the whole world. Have you ever seen this I go away from anybody? Yes. Only for that moment. When one has that unique experience of love, the I is replaced for that moment by the beloved. That's the only time the ego takes a back seat. The only power in this whole world, in this whole creation, that can put the ego away is the power of love. There's no other power. No amount of contemplation, no amount of actions, nothing can do it except love. Love can put the ego aside. And therefore, love is the power that is called bhakti yoga. Love and devotion to the beloved is the path of bhakti yoga. Krishna tells Arjun, you must practice bhakti yoga, which is a total surrender of your own consciousness to the consciousness of the beloved. You will then have an experience of the spiritual reality. But he says all these three can be practiced and are practiced by a person on the spiritual path, depending upon the stage through which one is going in the karmic pattern. Depending upon our destiny, how we are going through our destiny, all these three things are important. Therefore, at some point when we are very strongly committed to living an active life, karma yoga is very important. That means to be able to perform our actions without regard to reward, leaving the reward to the Creator. When our mind is very active and thinks and wants to find all intellectual solutions to everything, it is necessary to pursue that to the extent that the mind says, I cannot do this anymore. This is my limit. It's a yoga. When love and devotion arises, it comes from the beloved. The beloved pulls you. There is no way for us to say, I want to fall in love with somebody. You can try it, it doesn't work. It's not a mental game. You can have attachments, you can have artificial relationships, you can cultivate a certain type of attachment. And cultivation is very hard because you keep on have to say, I love you. Do you love me? Yes, I love you. Do you anymore? Yes, I still, do you still love me? That is not love at all. This is a mental game that goes on between people. It goes by the name of love. There's no love at all. There's a mental game. It's a game of egos, in fact. It's an egoistic game that goes on. The ego is being bloated. I love you more than you. Now you don't love me, I don't love you anymore. It's a clash of egos, and we call it love. When love comes automatically, naturally, with no mental effort, with no prior notice, as a surprise visit, when love comes and grows in you, it takes you by surprise and puts the ego aside. And you can think of nothing but the beloved. The beloved occupies the space in your consciousness. People say you should love God. That's the greatest worship, greatest prayer, greatest meditation, greatest way to achieve spiritual reality and spiritual goals. I agree. But how can you? There's no way to do it. Unless God pulls you into that experience of love, you won't have it. Tied up as we are in the physical universe and accepting the physical material things to be real, God is just a concept and a notion. We try to make it real. It does not become real. Again, it becomes a mental game. The whole game of trying to have love for God in a mental capacity is a very erroneous mental game. God is nowhere in the picture. Mind alone is playing that game. That is why that love does not last. People try that. Good things happen. God, thank you. You've done a good thing. Bad things happen. God, where are you? I want to fight with you. I'm angry with you now. What kind of love is that? This is a mental game again. How does God, the compassionate creator of all this, view this? If you were God, how would you view it? Which you are indeed. You just lost consciousness of that. You deliberately individualized and separated your consciousness to have a look at the show. You came for a show. You're taking it as real. But if you were the creator of the show, and you find that in the show you have created people who are seeking love of God, and you are God, how would you arrange it? The best way to arrange in the show, not outside of the show, in the show, would be that God walks as a character in the show. The best way. It was demonstrated by that famous pilgrimage. Anybody remember that story? Chaucer's story of Canterbury Tales? Chaucer, Geoffrey Chaucer, who's been given the credit for being the first author in English literature, in English language, to have created characterization. Previously, the stories, all the characters were robots. There was a king and there was a queen. It could be any king or any queen, it made no difference. The story was valid. Now, if you write a story, the king must be a particular kind of king, jealous king or having a particular kind of character. This characterization, to bring a character into character, the credit is given to Geoffrey Chaucer for having introduced this new concept 300 years ago in English literature by writing a book called The Canterbury Tales. It's a very simple book that there are a number of pilgrims in England going to their shrine called Canterbury. They're going to the shrine and it takes many days to go by foot and by coach. So to while away their time, while they're on their way to the shrine, they tell stories to each other. And they sing songs. So Chaucer in that book lists all the stories that they sing and describes those people. In describing them, he has created character. For example, he describes the wife of Bath in England, wife of Bath. I'm making it an American version, wife of Bath. That wife he describes not as just a wife of going to that place. He says that wife, husbands at church, she had five. She had five husbands at church. Without an other company in youth, but of that I need not talk of Nuth, which means besides her other company in young age, she had five husbands. I don't want to mention about the other company. The whole wife picture changes. It makes that woman look different after he describes like that. Then, of course, she sings her song. A lawyer, he describes an attorney, of those days. A lawyer, that looks very very contemporary to me. The lawyer, a busier man than him there was. Was means never was. A busier man than him there never was. A busier man than him there was, and yet he seemed busier than he was. Looks like a typical attorney's office. So then he tells what the attorney tells the story. So Chaucer is well known for giving character to the actors on the stage. In his book, he has written the book. He wrote the book. He describes all these people. And then he says in that book, I was also there. Chaucer also comes and walks along with the pilgrims. Now all these characters are created by Chaucer. The Chaucer that walks with them is also created by Chaucer. When Chaucer's term comes in the story to tell a poem, he says, I don't know any poetry. He's written all the poems. They say, come on, you are a great author. You know all that. Come on, tell us at least one good poem of yours. And Chaucer, when he recites a poem, comes out with the worst doggerel rhyme in the whole book. And not that he didn't know about it. He's immediately criticized by his own characters. Oh, we expected something better from you. That is foolish. This question has been asked as a comparison to a theological question. The literary question, why did Chaucer create a character of himself and be ridiculed and attacked by his own creation? This has been compared by theological studies to why did Jesus Christ, who was Son of God, one with God, who says, I and my Father are one. If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. When he could make such a statement, how could such a person who was one with the ultimate creator come into his own creation and be crucified by that creation? Looks like the two things are very parallel. How could God come in the form of a human being and be crucified by his own creation? How could Chaucer, the author of all these characters, become a character and be ridiculed by his own creation? What is the answer to that? The answer for the two situations is the same. The answer is, when Chaucer came in and got ridiculed by his own characters, he knew as the author, he was the author of all of them, including those who ridiculed. He was all of them. When Creator comes in the form of a human being like Jesus Christ and is crucified, he's not unaware that his entry here as a human being is amongst all who he himself has created. Therefore, nobody is crucifying nobody, except it's a play by the same creator. The author is conscious of the authorship of the whole play. Therefore, if God were to really come to enable us to practice what Krishna says to Arjun, practice as bhakti yoga, he would surely come on the stage of this show as a character of the same quality, of the same substance as the rest of us. If he did not come in that form, how is he expecting us to practice bhakti yoga on the physical plane? How can we as human beings say we want to be practicing bhakti yoga? We take this world as real. We take each other as real. Our bodies are real. This world is real. This is the only reality we experience every day from morning till night. And sometimes at night also, we experience this reality. Yet God, we want to worship you in some other form. How is it possible? How can it happen? If anybody claims that he is not taking this whole world as real and is trying to practice devotion to God in some other form, that person is playing nothing but a mental game. It's nothing but the mind fooling that person. You can check it out. That very person can check out within his own mind whether it wasn't a mental game. Therefore, from time to time, we have evidence that whenever God wanted to respond to the seeking of a seeker, he did not say quietly in some corner of the head, I am hiding somewhere, come and find me in that shrine. Come and look into that river. Come and find me in a cave. Come and find me on a mountain. Come and find me in a show. Come and find me in this church. Come and find me in a temple. Come and find me in a mosque. He never said that. He said, if you seek me, I'll come right in front of you, like you. and let you have the experience of love and devotion. Otherwise, how could there be so many people? We give credence and we give credit to so many masters, perfect living masters throughout history, and we forget that they were all human beings. Now we want to praise and want to worship something that is a shadow, some image in our mind, and we forget that every one of those examples we take were actual human beings walking on earth. Not only human beings, human beings who became so ordinary, took part in the show to such an extent that we crucified them, we killed them, we hurt them, they still loved us and proved to us that they were in fact the embodiment of God and not like other human beings with minds. What is the difference between a person who comes here and takes up a role amongst us so we can practice love and devotion and other people? What's the difference? The difference is that the person who comes and takes up the role for us to practice love and devotion loves us unconditionally. A human being using the mind can never do it. The mind insists on saying, what have you done for me lately? What are you going to give me for this? You made these promises. Why aren't you fulfilling them? That's no love. If you'll find ever a person who under all circumstances for all time gives you unconditional love, take it from me. That person is God in human form walking on this earth. No human being using mind can do that. It's impossible. Therefore, when we talk of these people in history and call them masters, call them saints, call them sons of God, call them by so many high-flowing and nobody can challenge, they are dead. We call them by these names after they are dead. We hardly ever call them. During their life, we kill them. After they're dead, we praise them as God. They were all human beings. How come we can't find a human being now with the same qualifications they had? What were their qualifications? Their qualifications were, they were ordinary like us. They suffered the torture like we do. They suffered the karma like we do. But their love and compassion for us was beyond what human beings normally do. Their love for us was unconditional. I tell you again and again, I have gone around the world. There is nobody who gives us unconditional love except a perfect living master. He gives us unconditional love under all circumstances. Therefore, when such a human being comes into our life, that's a turning point in our life. Because such a human being can draw out of us the love that is not mental, can draw out of us that feeling which I mentioned comes only once in a while. In a moment, it comes and the mind destroys it. He can pull it out, even though for a moment, and we can practice bhakti yoga. That's the only way we can practice bhakti yoga. Krishna did not say, now you go somewhere and sit in the wilderness and practice. He said, if you have faith in me, if you love me, you can practice bhakti yoga. And I, the dark-skinned man in front of you, are available for your bhakti yoga. Nobody has ever said that bhakti yoga is performed with a mental image. It's not possible. Love and devotion is not a mental game at all. And all games where concepts have to be used, where pictures and images have to be created for us to have love and devotion are mental games. Because it is a projection from our mind to go, I love you. That's not love at all. Where you have to have this sense that you are loving somebody, it's not love. Where you have to say to yourself or say to the other person, I love you, remember, it is not love. Where you are pulled by the other person, have no time to say anything, and something pulls you in a way you can't explain, that is love. Where your ego is replaced by the beloved, that is love. Where you are swept off your feet and you are swept off your ego by a face and by the eyes of a person who pulls you, that is love. And then you say you can practice love and devotion. But Krishna says these three yogas, the yoga of karma, karma yoga, sankhya or jnana yoga, or bhakti yoga, should be practiced as they come. at different stages of our life, we may emphasize one more than the other, depending upon our karma and our circumstances. Ultimately, he says, bhakti yoga is the top. Ultimately, you will find it's the top. What does it create? What do these three yogas create? Let's examine. Karma yoga, if you are performing skillful action with all your power and you are not expecting a result, what will it lead to? It will lead to a true detachment from this world. When you desire something, you have attachment. You do not desire a reward. You are really practicing detachment. If a person can put in the best effort without regard to reward, what greater practice of detachment can there be? Sankhya yoga, when you can press your mind to its extreme limit and find that mind can do nothing, what are you practicing except detachment? When love and devotion grows to a point that nothing but the beloved is inside your head, you're detached automatically. Cannot have detachment. Detachment cannot be practiced by itself as a spiritual method. Now, I won't tell you the story of the third person from Cambridge who had an experiment. But imagine a person says, I want to be detached from this world, and says, what are the things to which I am attached? Take me for example. I am attached to old times, Shakey's ye old pizza. Now it's replaced by Pizza Hut. Okay, nice pizzas are available. I say, I don't want any more pizza. I am going to be detached. Supposing I want to detach myself from my love of pizza, and I keep on saying, no more pizza, no more pizza, no more. Will it detach me from pizza? Is there any way, is there any mental process, is there any yoga that I can perform to get rid of pizza? No way. You cannot practice detachment with anything. I'll tell you another story. That's also a repeated story, but some of you may not have heard it. If you have heard it, forgive me for repetition. A man heard that there was a great yogi, a great miracle man, a great holy man sitting on the top of the mountains in Himalayas in India. And he had a power to give a whisper in your ear, a magic mantra by which you could get instant realization of the truth. So the man, obviously an American, because Americans want instant knowledge, instant everything, instant coffee, instant knowledge. He traveled all the way from United States to India, took all the trip back to the mountains, went over to a cave and saw the holy man sitting outside. And he said, I believe, sir, that you can give us a small mantra, a small repetition of some words by which we can get knowledge. He said, certainly, my son, I can. He said, can you give it to me? He said, of course, you have come such a long way. I can't let you go disappointed. I'll give you that little mantra. So this seeker crept close to the master, and the master whispered in his ear. He said, go to a quiet place and utter these words, abracadabra. He said, what? I have come all this way just to learn about abracadabra? Are these the magical words? And the master said, yes, these are the magical words, but there's a condition attached to it. When you are saying abracadabra, don't think of bananas at that time. The man tried thousands of times. Every time he would say abracadabra, bananas were in front of him. He could not get rid of it. The master actually taught him some very valuable lesson. There is no way to practice detachment by trying to go after it. You cannot detach yourself from anything by trying hard. The harder you try, the more attached you get. The harder you try, the more that number, the figure, the words come in front of you. How can you practice detachment? There is no way to practice detachment. Therefore, Krishna says to Arjun, you combine these yogas, but detachment cannot come except with the third yoga, bhakti yoga, because when you are in bhakti yoga, the beloved enters so much into you, you forget everything else, you get detached. Therefore, you cannot practice detachment to get over attachments, you can practice such a strong attachment that you detach from everything else. The practice is not of detachment, practice is of attachment. And you can find a child playing with a toy. I want to play with this puzzle. I don't like anything else. You bring a new puzzle. The child throws away the first one. The very puzzle the child was so fond of, attached to, would not let go. A new one has come and he lets go of the first one. He has not let go of the first puzzle, the first toy, the first distraction because of it trying to get rid of it, but because something else came that took his whole attention to such an extent the first one meant nothing. If something comes into our life stronger than what we have experienced in this world, if some love flows through us stronger than we have had anywhere in this world, that's the only way you can have detachment. A new attachment, a new love and devotion can create detachment. So attachment is to be practiced in order to achieve practical detachment. So these issues of attachment and detachment come all the time in our life, and we think that there is a way of mentally manipulating something to say, I am detached to this. And that by thinking about it, we are detached. We cannot be. We can only be detached if we are attached to something so strong and powerful that the rest means nothing to us. If you want to have an attachment that is strong enough and you want to have a spiritual goal, then why not have attachment to something that leads you to your spiritual goal? Supposing one wants to have a spiritual goal of going within to the reality and truth and meeting one's creator, or finding out if the creator and the self were the same thing. Finding the truth about this game. Finding the truth about creation. Somebody wants to go into deep meditation and attachments are coming in the way. I am sure you know, when you practice meditation, you try to concentrate your attention behind the eyes, at the third eye center. A lot of things come in front of you. Examine what they are. Most of them are your attachments. Most of the things that come and distract you from meditation, distract you from your spiritual pursuit, are your attachments. Those attachments come and pull you away. Attention is trying to rivet itself to the point behind the eyes, at the third eye center. And the mind is constantly bringing different attachments in front. Desires and attachments. Desires that led to attachments. And attachments themselves. They come in front and distract us, and we think of those things. We cannot concentrate here. Ultimately, it is the attachments that we have created. It's almost like every desire we had, in order to achieve it, we tied ourselves with a little rope. And we have tied ourselves with so many ropes and strings that when we try to feel we can just sit and close our eyes and be in meditation, all those ropes and strings pull us out. We have a hard time meditating. Then we realize how many attachments we have. And when a person is about to die, he should die peacefully. I have done my work. I have lived my life. I should go. But when a person is dying, oh, what about that person? What about my child? What about my house? What about my property? What happened to my bank balance? What happened to my new car I bought? Those things pull that person out. Does not allow a peaceful death. Does not allow a transition. Make sure that person has to come back to fulfill these desires and set up a new pattern of karma and be born in circumstances where those attachments can come back again as a play of destiny. So attachment is playing such a strong role. Attachment is creating all our problems. Attachment to things that will never become ours. The most interesting thing about attachment is that we are attached to things that will never become ours. We are attached to people that will never become ours. You want to try that? One day, just pretend you are dead. You'll see immediately the people that love you so much, what happens to them. Immediately, this is so strange that people have tried it and successfully found out nobody was their friend. Nobody talks anymore that I love you, I'll give up my life for you, I'll do all this. Then they say, where is his wallet? Where are the keys? They talk so differently. When a person dies, you pretend you'll find out who your friends are. Therefore, these attachments, we are trying to build up attachments and give our whole attention and give such a substantial part of the most valuable thing we have, which is consciousness and attention. We are investing it in things that will never remain with us. We go, oh, I love my car, I love my house. Has anybody ever taken their house and their car with them and they die? Alexander the Great, who conquered so many countries in his ravages through the Middle East and East, he went into India. He destroyed so many temples, he looted so many people, he made so many children orphans, he made so many women widows, he killed so many people, gathered all that, put all the wealth and the gold and diamonds on camels and was traveling back. As you might know from history, he died on the way. When he was dying, he said, can you give this wealth to somebody who can give me at least enough time to go back to Alexandria, to go back to my town? They said, sorry, the time has come. He said, how can I die? A gypsy once told me, fortune tellers, psychics, a lot of them, in this, they used to be all the time. Don't think it's a new phenomenon in America. These psychic and fortune tellers have always been very popular. He said, a gypsy told me, I can never die till the earth turns of metal and the sky becomes of gold. I cannot die. When he was very sick, they spread his armor on the ground and put him on that. And they put a gold shield to protect him from the sun. And he saw the metal on the ground and the gold on top. He knew he was going to die. But he never expected this is how the sky will turn gold and this is how the earth will become metal. But it did become like that. He said, gypsy was right. Let somebody take all my wealth and let me reach my capital. And the doctors attending on him said, no, your last time has come. There's no way to save you now. You have to die here. He said, if I have to die, do one thing. When you put my body into the coffin, keep my hand out like this. Let the whole world see. And you probably know that his hand is outside the coffin. He was kept outside the coffin. Let the whole world see that Alexander the Great, who acquired so much wealth, murdered people in order to acquire it, left empty-handed. Let the whole world know it. And nothing goes with us with death. And yet, imagine, these are the things we are attached to. Not only attached to, we are building these attachments with great joy. I am getting some new car, I am getting a new house, I am getting some new money, I am getting this thing. All these are things that will not go with you. We are pursuing these perishables, pursuing things that will not keep company, pursuing people who will leave us. And what are we doing this for? So that when we sit in meditation, these very things come and become blocks and obstacles to meditation. So God, why aren't you giving grace? And God says, I am giving you grace, but you are turning the other way. He says, God, what can I do? I have got all the children to look after. I have got all my friends. I got my house. I didn't even pay my insurance last time. I have to go and take care of it. If this is all you're going to do, God says, but I am on the other side. He says, no, I have to take care of these things first. Which is what Socrates wrote about in that allegory of the cave. Some of you might have read that. Plato, of course, quoting, giving credit to Socrates. As you know, that Plato gave credit for all his stories to Socrates, who was his master. So, Plato writes about the allegory of the caves, that the men who were trapped in the cave were looking at their own shadows and shadows of the things they were holding and taking them to be real. When a man came from outside with the light and said, turn around, the light is outside, the door to get out of the cave is behind you. These men who were looking at the shadows that they are going to attack, they talked to each other and they said, this man who's telling us to turn around is a conspirator with these shadows. He wants us to turn around so the shadows will attack us. They would not turn their face. The man said, these are shadows. They said, he's trying to mislead us. So we may be attacked by these shadows. This is our condition.
We have shadows all around us and we are so attached to them. We say, unless we find something better, somebody who tells us, be detached and get away, is co-conspirator and is making us lose our great heritage over here, our great assets over here. We are more concerned with things over here, which are like shadows. When we die, how do they disappear? When a person is dying, the attention is pulled off, everything disappears, floats away, like the world is gone. It is that kind of a world we are investing our attachment and our attention in. What wrong priorities are we giving? How misplaced this whole love is for things that are going to disappear anyway. So, to take the same example again, if we were to attach ourselves to something that will last, that will go with us, that will go out into the sun, into the open, and not attach ourselves to those in the shadow, it would be worthwhile. It is that kind of an attachment to something real that will go with us, that will be there beyond death, that makes for true detachment with the world. You can practice attachment to something real in order to be detached to the world. There is no other way of practicing detachment. But to be attached to that, you must be in love. To be in love, that person must pull you. Like the Muslim Persian poet says, Ishq awwal da dile mashuk paida mishawat. That love is first born in the heart of the beloved. Oh, lovers, don't think it is in your capacity to love anybody. If the beloved doesn't come and give you that smile, give you that wink, give you that sign, you can never have the experience of love. It cannot be you just pick a person and say, I'm going to love. Something happens at the other end which makes you fall in love. Remember this, that even in spiritual love, even in love with the master, even in love with God, something must happen from the other end before you can have that feeling and move towards it. Therefore, this kind of love and devotion is the bhakti yoga, the yoga of love and devotion that really leads to detachment. It cannot be done without it. Therefore, attachment and detachment, which are the most important subjects in our whole life, we're constantly trying how to find true peace, how to find joy in our life. Every time we examine why we are not peaceful, why are we so restless in our mind? Why don't we have peace of mind? We examine it with all the three yogas and we discover it is because of our attachment. Our attachments are the cause of all this turmoil in our head, in our life. At least we know we have diagnosed the disease, that it is these attachments to this world that is creating all our problems and all the lack of peace of mind. And we don't know how to practice attachment till somebody comes in our life. So we should seek that truth so somebody can come in our life and pull us by the power of love so that we can have true detachment, because there's nothing else worthwhile. When you meet a true friend, when you meet a beloved that pulls you like that, there's nothing else left of significance in this world. That is the practice of bhakti yoga and that is the practice of detachment. To do that, we have to meet somebody who's like us. People have been baffled over this question for a long time, that why do we need a guru? Why do we need a master? And I said, tell me any other way of controlling the ego. And I've not found one. Never, nobody has practiced successfully control of ego, control of attachments, except through this way. You can fall in love with anybody and have the same experience. But where will you go where that person goes? You will go wherever that object of your attachment goes, you will go there. Why not be attached where the you know the object is going to eternity, forever, to immortality, to our true home? Therefore, it is recommended that the true love can come with anybody, but the true love that survives if after death and goes on forever is with that friend who comes from true home. And a friend who comes from true home is the one who has that consciousness of the true home. Somebody says, is that person who is a master, does he have God in him? does God speak through him? And I say, sure. God is speaking through that person. He has God in him, but so is it in you. So is in every one of us. What's the difference? That person also has God speaking through him, so have you. You wouldn't be able to speak if God wasn't in you. You would have no consciousness if God wasn't in you. You would be dead, you wouldn't be born, you wouldn't be here. It's the power of God, the single conscious entity that makes us alive. Therefore, God is in each one of us. Then what's the difference between that master and ourselves? How is it different? If all of us are in fact with the same God, with the same power, same consciousness, what's the difference between that person and ourselves? The difference is, he knows it and we don't. There's no other difference. The difference is, he has experienced that awareness, that realization. He has self-realized his true self, and we have not. Not yet, at least. Therefore, there's no other difference. The difference between a perfect living master and ourselves is only this, that he has realized in consciousness, within, what that power of consciousness is, and we are still on the way. There's no other difference. Great master used to be asked this question, that master, in this modern world, democracies are growing, and people are electing rulers even. In some countries, even spiritual teachers are being elected by the communes, which is very strange. In the United States, in some associations, they elect a spiritual teacher by elections. That he should guide us. We want to elect him. So elections and democracy and equality are strong subjects coming up. How will the West accept a kind of philosophy where a master is treated like a king? Because a country like the United States doesn't have a king. They never had a king except in the small state of Hawaii. They never had in any other state any kings. So they are unaware, but they like royal treatment. Royal this, royal that. They use the kingly words. But they've never seen a king. And yet, every religion is teaching that there was a king. An unthroned king who was the master. How can the West believe, who are now used to equality and everybody being equal, how can they believe that one person amongst them can be a king? And great master used to explain that if you put a large number of radio sets to modernize the story, if you put a large number of TV sets and take the power source out of them, don't connect them with power, don't put batteries in them, they all look the same. They are the same. If you connect one of them to the power source, that one alone will give you the news of the world. In the same way, we are all the same. We are all equal. But the news of the homeland, the news of our reality can be given only by one who has been connected to the power source within. And that's the distinction that is made. Therefore, wait for a person who has the connection and can give us the news of our homeland, because that news alone we can treat and get connected ourselves and become just like that person. These great masters you talk of, they don't come here to make better people of us. They don't come to reform the world. If these people had come to reform the world would have been reformed long ago. Thousands of them have come. Thousands of great spiritual teachers have come in every part of the world. And the world is still the same. Some people think it's gone worse than before. Some think we are in the last stage of Kali Yuga, and therefore we are in a very bad state right now. What has happened to all these great reformers who came? They did not come to reform the world. They came to tell us, this is not your home. This is not your world. It's bad. It's terrible. It's an illusion. It's unreal. Get out of it. Go to something real. They never came to tell us how to make this a better farmland and the sheep should roam here. They came to pick up the sheep and take them back home. These shepherds did not come to leave the sheep alone to roam around in a better world. They came to take the sheep home. These masters have come to tell us this world has never become good. It's always been a play of good and bad, evil, morality. All these things are here. And this world will always be like this in order for the show to go on. But the seekers who want to get out of this, who are fed up of this show, there is a way out. And the master has found the way out. He can give the way. Therefore, he says, come along with me. I'll show you the way out. So the masters do not come to teach us how to make the world better. A lot of people are saying, oh, let's improve the earth. Let's save the earth. Go ahead, save it. But don't say you're on a spiritual path. You're on a path to save the earth. Some people say, oh, we are following a master. We want to save the whales. Go and save the whales before they are extinct. But don't claim you're on a spiritual path. You're on a path to save the whales. Understand, these things are different. The spiritual path is to be the spirit, to be the immortal self that you are. And go within to that part of your consciousness, which is the spirit. Then you're on a spiritual path. The spiritual path is not a mental path. It's not a worldly path. It's not a physical path. It's not an earth path. It's a part of the spirit. The spirit is that immortal soul that yearns for its totality, that longs for its totality, that longs for the beloved from whom the spirit seems to have been separated. It wants to be able to remove the separation and be one again. That's the spiritual path. Great master was told that he has taught people 5 stages of growth. From the physical, in this physical world, you find a master. You find a living human being like ourselves. You fall in love. He teaches you how to go within your own self. You go, you rise to another level, the astral level, the level of sense perceptions, where you can have all the senses without the body. And that itself is called a body. If you have all senses, but not the physical matter, it is still called a body. It's called the fine, the subtle, the astral body. When you find that, you are still among senses. You're still amongst birth and rebirth. Then you follow the spiritual path, go within the astral body, and you can go to a higher body which has no form, but only thoughts and concepts. It's called the mental body, the causal body. So you've gone up there. Then you go within the causal body, put your attention there, become oblivious of the mind, and transcend to the spiritual path. You find the naked soul, all in its purity and brightness and light. That's yourself. And then you find, how are you separated? You go within that soul and find that the totality lies within you. There is no real separation. Great master said, my spiritual path starts from Parbrahm, beyond the mind, from the point of the spirit, and ends where we become one. That's the true spiritual path. He says, but I have to teach them these other things, because when you put a ladder, you can't start from the 4th step. You have to go from the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd, 4th. One man who was initiated by a master who used to teach 5 words once came to me. He says, you know, I made a mistake all these years. I was repeating 5 words, which meant 5 stages, which meant 5 levels of consciousness. And I didn't realize that 3 levels belong to time and belong to Kaal and belong to the negative power. And I've been uselessly repeating 3 words. I should have only repeated the last 2. So for the last 2 years, I've been repeating only 2 words. Just to be on the spiritual path. And I said, did you make any greater progress? He said, no, nothing happens. I said, obviously, when there are 5 steps, you can't start from there. How can you go to the 4th step without climbing 1, 2, 3? So then he went back to all the 5 steps. The point I'm making is that the teaching has to start from where we are. God himself, if he comes here, teach us, will come from the point where we are. You will see a very strange thing. If you ever meet a perfect living master, you'll see a very strange thing, that the perfect living master in your personal life comes down to your level. He comes exactly where you are. He will go as down as necessary in order to make you feel you're at the same level. He does not need to. He can say, no, I'll stay up in heaven and I'll call you from there. He doesn't. Because he knows it remains a concept. But when he becomes so human that he comes to our level and becomes just like us and acts like us, falls sick like us, eats like us, drinks like us, dies like us, does everything like us, and has all the human strengths and weaknesses like us, he becomes a friend of ours. You can't be friend with Superman. You can admire Superman, I tell you a story that when, if a man who's got special powers flies into this room and remains 3 feet above the, 3 feet above the ground and is flying all over and we are watching, I have to stop my lecture. I'll be shocked to see such a person flying. You will all give more attention to that than to me. Nobody will listen to me. I look at everybody's face. What's happening to you? And you look at that person. Many of you will be struck with fear. Some might swoon, actually faint by seeing this. Some others will say, what a great thing. This is a true miracle today. God, you are real. Lot of things will be said. You may even worship. But nobody will love that person. One thing that will be missing will be love. Everything else will happen. And yet we are saying love is the very path, the spiritual path. So Superman flying over here cannot inspire us to have that which is needed for the spiritual path. If by chance he fails in his trick, while he's flying here, he drops down and is hurt. I know a lot of people from the front row will run, some from the back row to help. Are you hurt? For the first time, some sign of love will come for that person. Do you realize what we are talking about? We cannot love anybody unless that person is like us. There is no way to practice love with a super person. You can only have mental imagery. You can have fear, worship, anything else. Love is confined to something that we feel is so compatible with us, so much like us, that there is no difference left. We can see no super qualities except one, that the love of that person is unconditional. That everybody else, after a while, over time, seems to suffer from strange feeling, I can't carry on, the expectations are too much. Do you know why love with people breaks down? Because of expectations. We expect too much. That is why love relationship breaks down here. Here is a person who expects nothing. And therefore, the love continues. Our mind gets baffled by this. How is it going on and on and on and on? They don't realize, the mind does not realize, this relationship with a perfect living master who's become ordinary like us, totally ordinary, has not been set in motion for 6 months or a year or for life, forever. This friendship is forever. It's a friendship of the spirit that will never go. You can't find that anywhere else except with such a person who has in his consciousness reached that level which is forever. If a person does not have that consciousness, we can't have that experience. A master can take us only as far as he or she has gone. The master has gone this far, it'll take you only that far. You have to move on to another master. It doesn't matter. It's not a bad thing. Some people think it's bad to change masters. Not at all. When a person goes to elementary school, the teachers take you up to a certain level. You go to university, you get more educated than those teachers in the elementary school. It does not mean that you did something wrong by leaving those teachers. You had reached your grade and you are moving on. Which reminds me of the story of Mr. Trilok Chand. It bears repetition. An engineer in Burma named Trilok Chand used to work for the roads and buildings. And he was a great seeker. He wanted to find a real sadhu, a yogi, a master who would teach him self-realization. He looked all over in Burma. He couldn't find. He found a lot of Buddhists and a lot of ritualists and a lot of other religions. But he could not find a master who would take him to self-realization. Then he learned that in the city of Madras in India, there was such a master. Now this Trilok Chand was very tight-fisted with his money. That means every time he had to spend a rupee, say let's say a dollar, to understand in this currency, every time he had to spend a dollar, no, dollar is too much, dollar is 35 rupees. Every time he had to spend a rupee, which is less than 3 cents, I think. Anyway, every time he had to spend a dollar, he would say, shall I or shall I not? To be or not to be? And most of the time he would put it back in his pocket. As a result of this way of life, he accumulated, although he was on a small salary as an engineer, in the course of a few years, he accumulated 35,000 rupees in his account. He would never spend money easily. He had to be convinced it is absolutely necessary. He'll die without it. Otherwise, he won't spend money. Yet, when it came to the spiritual path of discovering a master, he spent all the money to make a journey from Burma into Madras. That means that was very significant for him. He came to Madras, found that sadhu who told him that you have to make sacrifice in order to achieve spiritual bliss and to enjoy the higher realization, you must make a sacrifice. He quoted stories from the past, King Janak's story and other stories, to tell him that you have to surrender three things, your body, your mind and your wealth. You have to surrender these three in order to get to higher knowledge. So, look at the seeking of this man. He said, I'm willing to surrender all three. And the sadhu said, let's start with the wealth first. How much money do you have? He said, 35,000 in my account. He said, transfer all that to my account. I needed it for building a temple. This man who wouldn't spend one rupee transferred all his 35,000 rupees to that man. The man immediately started his temple construction work. And he said, now, next is to surrender your body. So how do I surrender that? He says, look, he opened his mouth and said, look at my tongue. And he stretched his tongue and put it up and down. He said, it has no tendons at the bottom. I have removed the tendons of the bottom in my body with great torture. Not by simple surgery, but by sandpapering them. And since one cannot do it, I allowed my guru to do it. So I will do it to you. To surrender your body, you must go through torture. So I will pick up your tongue and sandpaper it with some very bad leaves, like nettle rash. And you will get that pain, and that will be your bodily surrender. And once the tongue is free, you can then meditate and do the third surrender, which is mind. To practicing in the various centers of the body, you will take your attention to various centers. With the tongue, you will control your breathing, because it's pranayama. Pranayama means to control your prana, control your air intake. Of course, he did not understand that prana is supposed to be life and not merely air. But a lot of people think that because the air we breathe, it gives us life. Therefore, prana used somewhere means the air we take inside the nose. That's not true at all. Prana means the breath of life, not the breath of air. But since most people think that you have to breathe through the nose, therefore that is pranayama. That sadhu also believed in it. And he said, in order to breathe with equal distribution of air, you must divide the prana equally between the left and the right. One breath should be taken from the left nostril and one from the right. And you must not use your hands to do that, because if you do that, your whole attention goes into the hands. Your hands have to be kept here. How do you do it within yourself? Through the tongue within. So tongue must be rolled inside. And the tongue should be used from inside the nostrils to block one and the other alternately while you breathe. And then you should repeat the mantra and you will get self-realization. Mr. Lokchand went through the whole torture. He not only gave up all his money, he went through the torture of separating his tongue from the tendons, and he did this pranayama and worked with that master for many years. Till he got stars and moons and all things he saw. And he said, Master, I want to see more. He said, I can't do any more. My work is done. Now you go and find another teacher. To cut a long story short, eventually this man, Trilokchand, came to the same teacher I had, the great master. And one day he was sitting with the great master and they were having a conversation which I overheard. And that is how I later on went back into this whole story with Trilokchand. The conversation was, great master, if I had known that the whole truth I am going to find is from you, from here, I would not have transferred the 35,000 rupees to that man. Great master laughed. He said, Trilokchand, you have no idea. The moment you came here, I transferred all that 35,000 to my account. And he explained to all of us sitting there, don't you realize in life you will come across many teachers who will take you to a certain point. It does not mean that's a waste. As you go along, the whole account is being transferred. It is one account. Your spiritual seeking is one account. It's not separated. You never waste your time. Whatever you have done was a learning point. Up to that point, it was a learning stage. You learn that much, you go into higher school, into university. Just like you learn other things in this world, so do you learn the spiritual things. In spirituality, great master said, no time was wasted. You needed to go through that. You needed to. If you had not learned that, some part of your mind would have rebelled against what is happening. You had to go through the chakras. You had to find out what all this pranayama is. You had to find out. You have to see the limit of what that can give you. And then come up above that. Nothing was wasted. And all that you did there, I have transferred into my account. And all goes to your credit right now. That is a great lesson for all of us who heard this. And made us change our thoughts. Because we used to discuss with other people, oh, you are following that master, you're wasting your time. There's only one perfect master. Go and follow that. People began to claim perfect masters as if they are religions. Like people claim their religion. I made a study at this very university, Harvard, on comparative religion. There are a lot of books available on every religion of the world in the Widener Library. Go and see. Great library. And I thought I'll find some common points in all the religions, such as love for the master, going within, doing certain things. At least something will be common, because people say that all the masters taught the same thing, which was love and going within. But the religious books say the religions are different. You should do this, thou shalt not, and thou shalt, and thou shalt not. And those are all rituals. What is making up religion today is so much ritual, so much external activity. And none of them matches. And therefore we fight. But one thing I found common, even in recorded religion, and after talking to people of different religions, each one believes they alone are the right one. Everybody else is wrong. This is the common thing. How can that be? So this was a great thing. This was a great thing to discover. A great master saying that no, every stage you are going through is part of the same process. And you cannot capture one and say, this is mine, the rest is wrong. But people have started doing to masters what they used to do to religion. They get hold of a master, this alone is the real one, everybody else is wrong. Great master said, at one time, there can be several masters in this world. And they were wasting their time in argument, trying to convince other people how their masters were wrong. Trying to find some flaw somewhere in order to find out which master is right, which is wrong. It's a waste of time and energy. You should understand. It's a spiritual path. It's going within. Wherever one takes you, go high. If you can't go anywhere else, find next step. Go higher. You know which is the way to true totality of consciousness. Whatever is leading you to that, go on with it. Don't stop and waste your time halfway. No, first I want to be convinced which road is right, which is wrong, and you never start the journey. Like the man walking in the Indian fields once fell into a well. And he groaned and moaned and inside and partly in water, partly outside, didn't know how to get out, couldn't see any steps to get out. And some passerby, hearing the man's groans and whining and crying, came and found a rope. He said, wait, I'll help you to get out. He brought a rope. The man went out of his way. He was going home or somewhere, and he went out of his way to help a fellow traveler who had fallen into a well. He brought a rope, put the rope down, and said, hold on to the rope and I'll pull it up, or you try and come up on it. And the man said, before I pull the rope, first explain to me why I fell into the well. He says, we can talk about it once you come out. He says, no, first explain to me if I catch the rope that you will not let me down again. First explain to me that the rope is strong enough. Tell me all these things before I touch the rope. He said, look, man, don't you think you're in the well? You're crying. Isn't there enough time to talk of these things when you come out? He says, no, I don't want to get out unless you first answer all my questions. So many of us are like that. We have an opportunity. We are trapped here in this well, which is worse than that well. And we know it. In this well of miserable world we are in a miserable life, we want to get out of it. Somebody gives us a rope and says, come out. So first answer all my questions. I have a lot of doubts about it. First answer all those questions, then I'll decide whether to pick up the rope or not. It's our situation. So we can put our time excessively into this useless discussion, useless questions, where something so obvious is in front of us. Okay, what does the spiritual master come and tell us? I found this path useful. My master gave it to me. I tried it. It worked for me. I give it to you. You try it. It may work for you. If it doesn't, try something else. The master does not say make it a religion. The master does not say don't go anywhere else. The master says it, this path, this methodology, this way worked for me. My master gave it to me. I tried it, worked. I give it to you. See if it works. And if we don't try it, we are like the man in the well. But if we try it, it doesn't work for us. Nothing has been lost. We try something else. So the masters are not out here to create religions. When they die, we create religions. Sometimes a master has been dead for centuries before we set up a religion. Many people don't know the Bible was written 200 years after the death of Christ. People don't know that most of these great texts in the Holy Granth was written several hundred years after Guru Nanak. That these scriptures, which we now say are from the mouth of that person, were written centuries after those persons had gone. And therefore, these are records kept by other people. And these books establish religions. And yet we use the name of those masters to propagate those religions. We forget the masters said something else. They said, find a way out of this mess. We have not come out to give a sectoral or sectarian message to a group of people. Look, you are the wise chosen ones, and therefore you follow this. The rest are all heathens. None of them said this. None of them said this. They said, our message is for whole of humanity. The masters give their message of love for the whole of humanity. And we, after them, start making them into divisions, into religious groups. And same religion. Muslims say, we believe Allah alone is the truth. La Allah illallah. The Allah is the only God. There can be no other God. What about Muhammad? Muhammad Rasool Allah. He's the prophet. He came to tell us what God told him. But God is one. And in the name of the same God, they have killed more than 100,000 people in Iran and Iraq, following the same Allah, swearing by the same Allah. They killed each other. Because some said no, his son-in-law was supposed to be the Khalifa. Others said no, the other person was to be the Khalifa after him. On a little historical fight, in the name of the same single God, they murdered each other. Look at the Christian faith, look at all other faiths, look at the division amongst Hindus and Sikhs, look at Sikhs fighting with Sikhs, look at the whole history of religion. So much bloodshed has been going on in the name of the same single God by the followers of the same God. Leave aside followers of two different gods, each claiming that he alone knows the real God. We have used our mind excessively to separate ourselves. We have used our mind to perpetrate aggression in the name of God who was all love. It's time we took a turn in our own lives and found that love is more powerful than aggression. And the religion which propagated separation, differences, should be studied from the point of view of the person in whose name the religion has been set up and find that he was universal and propagated love and compassion for everybody. So if we can turn our lives like that, we will be true followers of the path. And that way, we will also be able to appreciate anybody who comes. If somebody came to me and looked like a beloved, I'll catch him. I'll catch his feet. I'll kiss his feet. I'll not let go of that person. I will never question, are you a Christian? Are you a Hindu? Are you a Muslim? Do you belong to some other faith? I'll never question. This thought will not come. Here is a person who's full of love. Here's a person full of that awareness coming my way. How can I thank God enough for such a happening to take place? He has given me the scope of practicing love and devotion. He has given me the first time an opportunity to practice detachment and get real attachment to the one source that will take me to the spiritual home. I have said all these words to you today as an introduction to today's workshop. I'm sorry it was a long introduction. But sometimes
we need to clarify some issues in our heads before we get on to something which can become a ritual. I must remind you that even meditation has become ritual in most of the world, which is very sad. Because meditation was supposed to be a way of self-realization. And what is happening is that we are treating meditation as another religion, another set of rituals. People meditate in one way, they get nothing, they shift to another way. Now we found the real thing. They're going on doing the things mechanically like they did before. People suddenly find a master and say, we want to go to satsang, to his discourse. They like to say satsang because it's an Indian word. And they don't want to go to church anymore. They go to church, they used to go every Sunday to church. Things were uttered, the same truths were spoken. From one ear it went from the other ear. They went out and discussed where they'll have their next lunch. And they go to satsang now. And the same truths are uttered. They go from one ear, goes out from the other ear. They again plan the same lunch. And they think they found the truth. Because they no longer go to church, now they go to satsang. Therefore they found the truth. You can't find truth by replacement of rituals. You have found nothing new if you have merely supplanted one set of rituals by another. No matter what. No rituals can ever give you the truth. The only thing that will give you truth will be the love and devotion for a perfect living master, for God in a human form who walks in our midst and comes and pulls us out, irrespective of what religion we are practicing, irrespective of what nationality we have, irrespective of what color of skin we have, irrespective of our age or gender. If such a person comes and pulls us, that's true spirituality. The rest is just ritual. The rest is superstition. Some people think that the masters come to set up superstitions. Oh, don't do this. If you do this, this will happen. They practice fear on us. No, there are enough priests and mullahs and pandits in the whole world to teach us how to be afraid. They tell us how to practice fear. Masters come to make us fearless. They tell us there's nothing to be afraid of in this world. It's our own creation. How can you be afraid of it? They teach us the power of self-realization. You discover the nature of this whole show and make you totally fearless. But in their name, we set up different kind of rituals and superstitions. If you do that, you'll go to hell. If you do that, you'll be punished. If you do that, something wrong will happen. And living in a state of terror and saying you're practicing religion and spirituality. That is not spirituality at all. Spirituality brings the best fearlessness in you. Nothing has brought greater fearlessness in a person than following a spiritual path, which is following a perfect living master who's come with that consciousness that takes fear out of you. He takes superstitions out of you. Masters don't come to introduce new superstitions. They want to pull us out of existing superstitions. We have plenty of them already. Therefore, if somebody is teaching you new superstitions, run away. If somebody is teaching you love and devotion and going within your own self to find the truth that lies already inside you, follow that person. Don't follow the person blindly outside. Follow what the person is saying. The person is saying, if you are following that person, he turns around, he says, look, I am not walking outside. It looks to you, I am walking outside and you are walking behind me. Actually, I am walking inside you. You want to see where I am walking? Go inside. You'll see in a form better than you like here that I am really walking inside. You see the radiant form. You see the form that can convince you with its light that this form that you saw outside as a human, ordinary human being had some extraordinary thing when seen inside. Because this outside form was no more than a way to take you inside to that form. It's a great path. The spiritual path is the greatest. I don't know anything equal to that. Not only amongst different spiritual paths, I don't know anything in the world equal to that. There's nothing that can give us greater happiness, joy, than the discovery of this truth through the spiritual path. Therefore, I commend to you, if you are sick of this world, if you are not sick of this world, you love it, go ahead, enjoy it while it lasts, the fun lasts. After that, come back to me again. But if you are already sick of this world and you want to find something real, something that will give you true, everlasting happiness, something that will give you the experience of love that is not conditioned by what you give, unconditional love, then this is the spiritual path where the beloved pulls you
by becoming an ordinary person. And when you go within, you find that person was not ordinary at all. But outside, that person was always very ordinary. It's a great path. The discovery of this truth must take place at the point of your soul or consciousness. Any other method that you look at that wall on that picture, look at that dot placed there, you look at the circle painted there, you look at the ceiling in the diagram there, are false. They have to take you outside. If the treasure is inside, and they all say, all religions say that the treasure is inside you, the methodology is outside, the treasures are inside, how can you be going in a direction that is opposite to where the treasure lies? All methodology must lead to taking you inside. If it is taking you to the right spot inside, follow it. It's taking you away from that, discard it. Because taking you can't go this way when you start moving this way. Which reminds me of the story, oft repeated again, bears repetition. A woman in an Indian village was knitting something with a sewing needle, was sewing something with a little needle, and she dropped the needle, lost it. So she was looking for it under the street light, and a young man came and said, "Ma'am, have you lost something?" She said, "Yes, I lost my needle. I was doing some needlework, and the needle dropped from my hand, so I'm looking for it." He said, "May I help you find it?" "Sure, son, go ahead." So he also began to look for it. He said, "Ma'am, do you have any idea where exactly you dropped it?" She said, "Yes, I dropped it in my house." "Then why are you looking for it in the street?" "I have no light in my house, son. Therefore, I'm looking for it here." It's our state. This story is ours. The truth is inside. We close our eyes at dark. Therefore, we open and go and look for it elsewhere. Aren't we doing the same thing? We laugh over that lady and we are doing the same thing. The truth lies inside. When we shut our eyes, it's dark. Therefore, we open our eyes and run to every other place to find the truth. How can we find it? We must discover the thing which looks dark now and brighten up with the light that is available inside. That's only possible if we know how to practice going within. Practice how we can be inside. And when we go inside and meet our beloved, it creates true detachment. Therefore, the practice of going within is the first step in practicing detachment. Because you can get an attachment there, which will always be good, because going within will always take you within to your truth. Going outside may take you away, further away from the truth. So in this workshop, I want you to practice a little bit. Whether you are already initiated into this system, whether you're already practicing it, or you're newcomers, or just students who want to understand what it is, I think it's worthwhile knowing what this point is behind the eyes, where if you put your attention, you will get filled up with light. I am not joking, lest you think that I am saying it in a kidding with you, or just making light of this statement. I am telling you, truthfully, if you withdraw your attention to the point you forget what is outside, put your attention behind the eyes, not at the eyes, behind the eyes, you can put your attention and feel you are there, you will see so much light there you've never seen outside. The solar sun will look very bleak compared to the light that is inside. It's not said in vain, if thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be filled with light. It's not said allegorically. It's truth. It's been said by everybody. If you want to see a jyot, you want to see the candle that burns forever without wick or wax, go behind these eyes and you will find it there. Therefore, I want you to practice at least finding that spot where, which is the real place for doing any kind of worship, any kind of meditation. You may be practicing any kind of meditation. You should do it at the right place. I ask people, do you do meditation? Yes. Where? I have a corner set in my room. I've got a special chair made, very relaxing chair. I've got a carpet that I imported from a mystic Sufi's house in Iran. I've got a special magical carpet that came flying from Aladdin's house. And I use that. I say, but you are then doing a meditation on the carpet. Your attention is on the carpet, on the chair, on everything outside. What about going within? And I remind them of what great master said, if you want to meditate successfully, you must locate the place of meditation first. First, you must put yourself in that place. Somebody said, this is something new you have come up. We have been hearing about your great master's teachings through many masters who came after him, and they told us how to do meditation. This is a new thing you are coming up with, that you have to be at the third eye center to meditate? We have a book from great master in our library. They pulled out a book. The name of the book was Spiritual Gems, which are extracts from letters from great master to various people who wrote to him. Here's a book. I don't know, 400-500 pages book. It doesn't speak about going to the third eye to meditate. What are you talking? I said, I am surprised. Great master in these edited letters never referred to that. But at that time, I must confess, I had never read any books. So I became a student of books from that point. I said, give me the book. Let me study it. So I went home. As I started reading it, again and again the letter said, you cannot even start meditation unless you are at the third eye center. I marked that place. After I marked about 12 of these, I returned the book. I said, look at the marks. I said, oh, we didn't read that part. I said, what part of the book do you read? I said, do you read all that is written there or what you'd like to read? And then I discovered that I met many people after that who tell me, I read this book, I didn't understand anything. I read it 5 years later, it meant so much. Another person said, after 10 years, there were new things in the book. I said, they were printed already. The mind seems to scan things it wants to read. Just like a man goes to a discourse of the great master and hears only what he wants to hear. And the master said everything. I had a very old relative, great-grandmother. Not grandmother, great-grandmother. She was so old, we had to carry her. When she was so old, my dad said, well, she's getting so old, she might die. Let's take her to one of the master's discourses. So we took her to the discourse in Bias, near the river, where the master was giving his lecture. And we seated her as close as she could. She could listen to the master. At the end of the talk, the master would say, give general instructions where people can go. There are no toilets and so on. So he said the ladies should go on the left side, the men should go on the right side. So he gave those instructions. And we brought the lady back. Said, did you enjoy this lecture of great master? She said, oh, wonderful. What did he say? He said, ladies should go on the left side. That's all she remembered. So I realized that every one of us has this weakness, that whether we read a book or listen to somebody, we love to remember that part, which is already in our mind, fits our mind. Say, wow, that's what he said. That means it's a confirmation of what we already know. We don't want to learn anything new. We want to learn what we already have learned. And then we feel very happy. It was a great talk. Why? He said something I already knew. Therefore, the masters have said this again and again. And in that book I found, he says your meditation cannot even begin. You cannot even start praying usefully unless you are at the third eye center. That is the place. This head of yours should be considered like a room, prayer room. This is a natural church. This is a natural temple. This is a natural mosque. This is created by God, made by God, not by any human bricks and stone and wood. This is made by nature. Therefore, use the natural place of worship. Sit in that. And look at the opening there in front of you. The mihrab, as they said. Or the opening gate of the temple. Or the curvature of the church under the steeples. Go walk in there. In this beautiful door. Get inside this church. Sit there and watch the candles. And watch the music. And watch the chanting going on. That's what they say. We run everywhere else when we are carrying the real church with us, carrying the real temple with us on our heads. And we have read in the very scriptures we go out to listen to them there, it says that this human body is the real temple of a living God. We hear that, we go way out carrying the temple with us to go to another temple to hear that this is the real temple. We come back, we neglect this, we put some all kind of bad thoughts, all kind of criticism of other people, all kind of jealousies we express through this temple. We put all kind of junk food into this, and then we go in a holy way, holier than thou, run to the outside temple and sit there and say, we come to worship the Lord. What has happened to our priorities? What are we doing to the real temple and what are we doing to the man-made temples? So we have misjudged this. The real prayer hall, the real place to do any kind of worship, to do any kind of prayer, to do any kind of meditation, is this great, beautiful temple. It has two parts, this body. One below the eyes, one above the eyes. The one below the eyes has all the energy centers. The whole of our life's experience is running through the six centers below the eyes. All our emotions, all our fears, all our feelings, all our energies, all our feelings of up and down, everything is coming from the centers. You want to go into those feelings? Go below. You want to have extraordinary powers, energies to wreak vengeance on people, to control them, to do those things? Go below. You want to find self-realization? You want to find love and beauty and joy? Go above. Consciousness and the discovery of higher consciousness lies above the eyes. And the energies that flow through the system lies below the eyes. The grand division. A lot of sadhus and yogis have spent their whole life trying to understand these centers of energy. They've got riddhis and siddhis, controls over, extraordinary controls over powers of nature. It's great to have that. Somebody's interested in that? Yes. Practice everything below that. If you want to practice self-realization, want to practice the great beauty of love and intuition and joy and true realization, and to discover who you are, go above. Therefore, this is the seat from which the spiritual path of consciousness begins. When you practice this in this real temple, then make this division into a firm dividing point. Because all our life, we are involved with energies, and the tendency to go down is very strong. We have to resist it. Every time people want to meditate, they want to sit here, they go down automatically. In my workshops, I find many people go to sleep very easily, even those who are insomniacs. Those who take pills to get sleep, they go to sleep easily in the meditation class. Because I tell them, stay here, stay awake, and they go to sleep. The tendency is so strong to avoid this area. The mind resists going anywhere which leads to its destruction, leads to its loss of control. Therefore, the mind tries to keep us in the lower chakras. And the spiritual path is to go at this level and above. So we must discover that place behind the eyes where the whole of our system actually exists. Not only the physical body. The physical body is all over. Our hands and feet and extremities have gone way out. The torso and the various energy centers on the torso that perform all these functions right up to the brain, all these functions in the body are taking place on an automatic natural basis. But the control point of awareness, of consciousness, from where we can say, yes, my hand is on the right, my foot is in front, that control point from where we can say this silently, quietly to ourselves through awareness is behind the eyes. It's always in the head. That does not move anywhere else. In the wakeful state, we are always there as a control point, as the focal point of consciousness, as a focal point of awareness, we are behind the eyes. And that is why that point should be the starting point for any kind of meditation, any kind of worship, any kind of prayer. So in this workshop, I want you to practice, because that will help you a lot in understanding attachment and detachment. Okay, we have a short period of starting the first exercise in which I want you to just discover your space. We'll carry on more in the afternoon session, but I want you to discover the space that lies behind the eyes. Those who have already done it can immediately go to the third eye center and start their meditation. Those who have never done it should close their eyes and look with their mental eye of attention. Attention, because the physical eyes are closed. So you have to look with the eye of imagination. Let me call it imagination. Use your imagination to explore the area that is behind the eyes within the head. Find out if there's a nice place to locate your carpet, the magic carpet or the chair or whatever you use for your meditation. Bring it here now. This is the time to bring that mat, the chair, the place to sit on. So you can, in your astral body, in your imaginary body, in your subtle body, sit on that and start your meditation. So find that place behind the eyes. As a clue, I can tell you, it is as much behind from the physical eyes, almost in line with the ears. So if you draw a line from one ear to the other, and draw a line directly behind your eyes, it'll become a line between the ears and two lines coming from the eyes. The midpoint of the line from the ears, the midpoint of that, between the two lines of the eyes is approximately the point where you'll find you are located as a third eye. If you want to be more simple and not to go into this calculation, then use your hand, look at the fingers. These two fingers, let the nails are representing the eyes. They are placed like this vertically in front. If you were to travel back at an angle where they both meet in the middle of the head, that is the same point. So you can discover a point. Imagine, in this first exercise, imagine you are there. Imagine you are sitting there. Imagine you are standing there. Imagine you are turning around and looking around. Imagine you are exploring what is inside the head. Locate that space. Close your eyes and begin. Don't think of other things at this time. Just try to locate the place. Be behind the eyes. Just imagine you are there. Don't struggle. Don't put any strain on your eyes or on your head. This is not a physical exercise. It's an exercise in imagination. Very relaxed. Don't be too serious. Enjoy it. Have a smile on your face when you do this. Don't worry about what is coming in front of you. Let those images, pictures come and go. Let any colors, lights, patterns come and go. Don't watch. Just try to locate yourself in the center. Don't concern yourself with anything around you but the center. Be in the center of the head imaginatively. Is behind the physical eyes. Same level. Don't go to sleep. Explore. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Look this side. Open your eyes. Open your eyes. I find some of you already started enjoying this. Any one of you enjoyed this session? Short? Oh, boy, a very good class. High percentage. Our higher self, our higher body, which looks like an imaginary system, but it's not so imaginary after all. And I want to introduce your own higher self to you, which has strong sense perceptions, stronger than you have on the physical body, and yet that system is fitted right into this. Your astral body. Astral? They call it astral because astral is associated with sky. That if you leave this world, another sky opens up. Therefore, it's astral. There's no other reason for it. You can call it subtle body. You can call it the weightless body. Many people in this country will love a weightless body. That body is actually weightless. It has no weight. It can fly. Like the space people do, astronauts do. All of you can do that with that body. Hardly possible with this body. With that, it's normal. So I want to introduce you to yourself through this next exercise. In this exercise, you will set up your place of meditation. You close your eyes and you'll find that behind your forehead, this is your front wall of a room.
and the sides are the side walls, and the back is the back wall, you are sitting in the center. You choose to decorate. Make a decoration for this room into which you will be going all the time for meditation. So it's best to have a nice environment and a nicely decorated place where you have to go and spend so much time. So you decorate this meditation room, which is your own head. But decorate from inside, not outside. Inside, you can embellish the walls, but embellishing the walls too much will not help, because after a while, you will find that the walls expand and disappear. The space inside grows with meditation. Ultimately, it opens up as a whole new universe and a new sky. So, putting too much on the walls will not help. So, the best is to put something where you are sitting, immediate vicinity, which is the center of the room, center of the head. When you are sitting there, choose a chair if you like, an asana, or a mat, or a rug, or a carpet, or something which you like, a cushion, a sofa, whatever is your most convenient place of sitting, imagine you have it. Imagine it in the color that you like best. And after you sit down there, imagine you have a table next to you. On that table, there lies a vase or vase. What do you call it? Vase or vase? Vase. You call it a vase? You all understand a vase? Any understand vase? Okay. The same thing. Okay. You have a vase with nice flowers of your own choice. You put those flowers next to you on a little table. This is what you have to do by imagination. The rest I will tell you when you get into the room. And you do as I tell you when you're in the room. So now close your eyes. Do this part of the exercise. Close your eyes. Make up imaginatively a nice chair or a nice cushion or a nice carpet or rug to sit on. Sit in the most usual meditational pose that you like, cross-legged or straight on a chair, with your hands in the normal position there you would be, and sit in the center of this room, which is inside your head. Sit very comfortably, smilingly. And once you have established where you are sitting, imaginatively put beside you a little table with flowers. Now make one more thing on the little table. Besides the flowers, place a little plate of your famous dessert. Or famous, if you don't like sugar, you don't like desserts, your famous, most favorite snack that you love to eat. Put a snack next to you, put the flowers next to you, and sit comfortably and smile. And relax. No stress on you at all. Absolutely relaxed. Totally relaxed. Sit there in the center, relaxed. Look at the flowers, look at the snack, and look forward. And if anything comes in front, any faces come in front, ignore them. Let them come and go. Don't bother to look in front what is happening. Just concern yourself with your own chair, your own rug, your own flowers, your own snack beside you. When you have done all this, raise your right hand so I know that you have done it. Lower your hands. Those who haven't done it, do it now. Lower your hands after you have achieved the imagination necessary to set up this stage where you're sitting peacefully in complete relaxation. And there are the flowers and the snack waiting beside you. Now pick up the flowers. Pick up the flowers and put them in front of you and look at them. Look at their color. Watch closely. Look at their shape. Look at the shape of the flowers and the color. Take them to your nose and smell if they have any fragrance. Are they perfumed or do they have no smell? Test it out. Put those flowers back on the table next to you. If you didn't succeed in having a good look at them, pick them up again. And see them again carefully. What flowers are they? Have you seen them before? Are they your favorites? Do you like the color? Look at them carefully. And put them back again. Now pick up the plate in which your snack is placed. And look at the snack. Does it have a smell? Does it have an aroma? Does it have a flavor that you can smell even without eating? Now taste the snack. Use a spoon, use your hands, use a fork, whatever you can imagine and is necessary, and taste it. Eat it. If it tastes good, eat the whole of it. Just enjoy the taste. See what it tastes like. Now put the plate back on the table and touch it on the table to make a little noise. See, is it made of china? Is it made of metal? What is this plate made of? See how it clinks on the table. Shake it on the table and see how it sounds. Can you guess what the metal is? Whether it's china, porcelain? What is this plate made of? Check it out from the sound. Put it back on the table. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Open your eyes, look the side. Those who haven't finished their snack, is their bad luck. Gave you enough time. How many of you were able to see the flowers? Please raise your hands. See the flowers clearly. How many of you were not able to see the flowers? How many of you were able to smell the flowers? How many of you were not able to smell the flowers? How many of you were able to taste the snack? How many of you were not able to taste the snack? How many of you were able to find out what the plate was made of by its sound? How many of you could not make out? Did any one of you see a flower that you have never seen before? You did? You've never seen in life? Can you describe it?
It's more than one, but one of them was yellow, and it was sort of a tulip, but with sort of a fat bottom, and then it went up like this and it curled around.
You never seen anything like that?
No. So what?
You didn't intend to imagine that?
No. I was trying to imagine flowers that I knew.
Right. Anybody else saw a flower that they've never seen before? Did anybody have a snack that was very tasty? You haven't tasted before? Or just the one that you normally like? Did you get your favorite snack? Did it taste good? Was just a memory of old times, or was it fresh just now? Did you get the taste right now? What was the plate made of? Were you able to guess? China? Crystal? Bone china? Any other?
Porcelain?
It
started with a box of chocolates. And then it changed into a china plate because you had mentioned China a few times, and the next thing I knew, it switched to China.
Right.
I don't know why.
What is happening? Are we not impressed by the power of imagination? Here was an imaginary feast. Materially, none of this existed. But with the power of imagination, we exercised every sensory perception. The point is, the sensory perceptions are not dependent on the body, nor are they dependent on the matter. We can have all these perceptions. And here there's an example of a flower that has not been seen, but came up there. She'll be surprised later on to find such a flower really exists in the world also. That she could see it somewhere else before she has seen it in this world. These are experiences to show us that our inner self, our inner imaginary body, our imaginative self,
has more in it than we give credit for. And if it has all this stuff, then that part of us can be very usefully employed even in meditation. That if we want to imagine we are there, we are there. If we want to imagine we are behind the eyes, we can imagine we are behind the eyes. Now, some of you had a very hard time to imagine this. I know one of my friends always has had this. And he says, what is this wrong with me? He almost wants to be excluded from this experiment. He says, everybody else imagine this, and I never imagine.
I can never see color on demand.
I see. So you have a problem with color?
Yes.
Okay.
Except when I see color, it's vivid. But it's not because I directed it.
Right. There are some blind spots we all have. We have blind spots here, we have blind spots there too. And there are some blind spots even in the causal region. Even in the mind we have some blind spots. And those blind spots block out some parts of experiences which some others can have. There's nothing unusual. But what we have is what we use. Yes.
Can we float in and out of one another's field, energy field, when we do something like this?
Yes.
I have some fleeting experiences of what both these women were talking about. They kind of
chased my joyful.
Yeah, and I saw a poppy. It sounded like that, but it was sort of flowers.
Sure, poppy, but that wasn't the poppy.
That wasn't.
I have poppies in my garden.
But is it possible that at that astral level we're floating in and out of?
You do, yes. Very much. You pick up from each other's field a lot. In fact, I'll tell you a very interesting thing. In the astral level, the thoughts are picked up almost immediately as a normal way. We call it telepathy, but here telepathy is not fully understood. In the astral level, it's automatic and natural. It's not, let me communicate with you and I'll think like this, then you'll pick up. It doesn't happen like that. Automatically, as you think, everybody around you knows. So therefore, that's an automatic way of communication there. If you do meditation and feel you have no body, no physical body left, and then whoever you will meet, you'll be able to communicate instantly by knowing what they are thinking. That's normal communication there. It's not extraordinary. Here we make a lot of noise about having got these special powers. We all have them. It's nothing unnatural. Only we are clouded. We have been dumped with too much of matter over us. Therefore, we can't experience it. I'll now lead you into an experiment of the real most valuable thing, and that is a feeling of love and devotion at the third eye center. You should have a beloved. If you don't have a beloved, create one. Imaginatively. If you really love somebody, this is a good time to see that beloved.
Yes. An animal? A pet?
Anything.
Yes.
Human being is better. If you have a choice. If you have a choice, pick up a human being. If you don't have a choice, then pick up an animal.
But with a human, there's going to be some attachment, yes?
Yes. Attachment and love. What you think is love or attachment or infatuation or just a crazy idea. Sometimes we expect a lot from our pets. Yeah, so it's not true that we do not expect anything. We do expect, our expectations get built up. But for this exercise, we are not really concerned with whether it's a pet or not. What we are concerned is, how can we, sitting in the third eye center, express our love and devotion? It's more subjective than objective. What happens to us? It's not what happens there, what happens to us. If we are in a state, the reason why I'm letting you go through this is because real meditation, meaningful, successful meditation will require that you be in that mode. If you are in a mechanical mode, that you are doing it mechanically, let me say, eyes closed, I repeat my words and I do this, nothing will happen. But if you sit there with love and devotion, crying out to your Lord, your beloved, whoever it is, and saying what you really want to say, inwardly, silently, when you can feel that, when you can feel it strongly inside you, What is happening to you is creating up, opening up doors and showing you lights which you cannot see otherwise. Your progress depends upon the degree of earnestness, intensity of seeking as expressed in your love and devotion at the place of meditation. So that is why it is very important that all meditation should be done with that feeling of love and devotion to make it successful. If you want to do meditation for 40 years and say, I have been meditating, following the system for 40 years, I really never, except once in a while, little some stars and some little streaks of light come, I see nothing. Obviously, you have been doing nothing but mechanical, robot-like meditation. But if you say, oh my God, when I sit in meditation, I am pulled. I forget who I am. I forget where I am. The whole world opens up. The sky, I forget if I have got my eyes closed or open. The sky opens up. And I'm transported to another world. And I see lights that I've never seen before. See colors I've never seen before. You are surely doing it with love and devotion to lift you up so rapidly. So it is a very important constituent of good meditation to do it with love and devotion. And since love and devotion cannot just be created by saying it, there has to be a feeling in it. Just go through an exercise, an imaginary exercise, so that it helps us in the process of meditation. Yes?
I have a thing where I can't stay there. You know, like when you were saying, hold it there, that was where I can imagine it and I can see things, but I can't hold the concentration.
Did it go down?
Mm-hmm. It dropped.
Every time?
Quick. Yeah, most of the time.
So you have to practice that.
But how do I practice it?
Practice by holding.
Like it's fluttery, just like it's like a butterfly in there.
But practice will make it perfect. Practice means doing it over and over again. Oh, I must tell you the story before we go into this exercise. Once upon a time, these are Indian stories, they're generally about kings and queens. Once upon a time, there was an Indian king, and he was very good in hunting and using his bow and arrow. He was so good that he could take an arrow, stretch the bow like this, and shoot the arrow exactly where he wanted. Supposing he had to shoot something like this, supposing I said, can you shoot your arrow into this cup? And he's there. He said, yes. He'll send the arrow up. It'll come down and go exactly into the cup. He was so good. Excellent. And he was very proud of his arrowmanship, or whatever it's called. Bowmanship. Whatever. You understand. He was very proud of his skill. One day he was coming after a hunt in the forest and he saw his queen standing on the balcony of the palace. And she was wearing one of that heavy jewel that they wear on the forehead. In India it's a custom, they sometimes wear it. And I said, the jewel, it hangs right up on the head like this. And he said, let me surprise my queen today. Let me surprise my wife. How skillful I am. So he took his arrow very skillfully and he shot the arrow. The arrow went and lightly grazed that, took it off, and she didn't even know. And the ornament fell down. Proudly he saw he was successful, so he walked up and said, my dear, I think you used to wear something on the forehead. She said, yes, oh, must have dropped somewhere. Didn't you know when it dropped? No, I didn't. See, I did it. She said, how did you do it? There it is lying on the side with the arrow in it. I shot an arrow and it took the ornament away and there it's lying. And the wife very coolly said, well, that's nothing much. By practice, you can do anything. He felt so outraged at the lack of appreciation, at the lack of admiration he expected. He says, what kind of woman are you? You don't appreciate what I did for you just now? I'll banish you. And he called the guard, said, this woman is no good for me anymore. I did such a great thing. She never appreciated. Go and leave her in the forest to be eaten up by the wild animals. So they took the wife and left her in the forest. And gradually all the forest animals came and they were wondering what this woman is doing in the forest. They became friendly with her. And there was a female elephant in the forest. And the female elephant gave birth to a baby elephant. Pretty little baby elephant was born. And this woman loved the sight of that little baby elephant, she went and picked up the baby elephant. And there was a little pool there. She gave it a bath and a wash and lifted the baby elephant like this and went around in three circles around the mother elephant and put the baby elephant at the feet of the mother elephant. The mother elephant looked very overjoyed. Somebody takes good care of my baby. Every morning, this woman would lift up that little baby elephant, give it a bath, give it a wash, and take it around the mother elephant and put it down on her feet. Gradually, the baby elephant kept on becoming bigger and bigger. But since she was doing it every day, she didn't notice it was getting bigger and bigger. Her muscles, her arms also became stronger and stronger. Even when the elephant was quite big, she was able to lift it and throw it up and down. One day she was lifting like this, a big elephant. And some people came to the forest and they saw a woman carrying an elephant. They couldn't believe their eyes. They said, "Look, woman, how did you learn this?" She says, "No, I do it every day." "Wow, come on with us. We'll give you a big contract. We'll take you into a circus company. If you give this kind of performance, we can all become millionaires." So the woman was hired by those people. They set up a company and she demonstrated how she can lift up a big elephant. And thousands of people would throng to see that. Ultimately, the news went to the king that there's a woman in town who can lift a big elephant. He said, "Arrange a show in my palace." So he organized the palace show. All the courtiers came. The king came. Woman came and lifted up a big elephant. The king was amazed. He went up to the woman and said, "You are really great. I had never seen anybody do this." And the woman said coolly, "By practice, you can do anything." Immediately, the king realized she must be my wife. Nobody else can say this. So he took her back and made her a queen again. So that's the happy ending of the story. But the message is that by practice we can do anything. Sometimes I was a civilian officer in India. I had a nice house, big, and there was a large, big open space next to my house. It was part of the house, but not used, except for landing of helicopters or something in an emergency. And a circus company came and said, "Can we use that wide space next to your house to set up a circus?" I said, "All right. I don't use that place. You come on." So set up a circus. It gave me a chance to see how those people practice. Standing up on those ropes, walking on ropes, and little kids doing things. I saw the cruelty side of it, and I saw the perfection side of it. I was very affected by that couple of weeks that they were there. But one thing that struck me was that the amount of concentration and practice they put into it, if that is put into it, if we put that kind of concentrated attention and practice into our meditation, we'd all succeed. Convinced me. We take it too casually. We don't succeed because we don't give that kind of a concentrated attention to it. And that was a big lesson. So I must again say that what is hard today and looks difficult, the holding of attention at a point, can be easily achieved by practice. So practice is needed, which means doing it over and over again with a will to succeed in it. So whenever we have a problem like this, we can practice, and practice can make us perfect. Now I want you to join me in that exercise, the last exercise of the day, in which we go into our decorated room and express our feelings for the Lord, for the beloved, for the one we really love, whoever it is. And that should be done silently, with a smile. If you have a problem by smiling and have some complaints to make, you can do those too. With anguish if you want to. But if you are neutral to it, good to do it with a smile. Express your love and devotion because of the many miracles you've already seen. If you have not seen any miracles, then you can give some anticipatory thanks to the Lord for the miracle that will come. How many of you have seen miracles for which you feel you can be thankful? So you know what to do. Close your eyes. Go back to your third eye center,
your place of worship. And do nothing but stay there, do your mantra, do whatever you like, but express your love and devotion in the best possible way that you can. Express your love and devotion, real or unreal. If you have real love and devotion, express it. If you don't have it, pretend you have it. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Open your eyes, come out. How many of you liked this last session? Thank you. How many of you thought I should not ask you to open your eyes at this time, but stay on in this mode for longer? Thank you. Thank you. I'm sorry I had to cut short your experience, because this is a limited workshop, just sampling of things. It does not mean what you did should be done only today. You should do it other times also. This workshop was designed to give you an introduction to certain things. For those who are already initiated into meditation, this workshop should help you to improve the quality of your meditation. For those who are not yet initiated but hope to be one day, this workshop will give you the practice necessary to prepare in advance. For those who are not interested in initiation at all, not interested in this lifestyle, it'll help them to get clarity in thinking on these issues generally in life. So it's a win-win situation for everybody. And I have really enjoyed working with you in this workshop, and I hope you have enjoyed it too. Did you think it was worth your while to spend this day? You raise your hands if you think it was. Thank you. So I'm very pleased that it went on very well. I must tell you, from the quality of classes that I normally encounter, this was a good class. And I could see a lot of beauty and a lot of earnestness and a lot of seeking. And I can only say that this was a great experience for me. And I hope that you will all benefit from this and enjoy your spiritual adventure. Take life very easy, in an easy way. It's not worthwhile getting too serious about things. Do not lose the ability to laugh at anything. As you know, sense of humor is the eighth sense. Five senses are of the five sensory system, which I mentioned. Sixth is the sixth sense, the intuition. Seventh is common sense, which is very uncommon. And the eighth sense is the greatest sense of all, which is the sense of humor. The sense of humor which enables us to laugh and look at things in that way. So if we live with this eighth sense, we are not likely to get depressed. So it's nice to be able to laugh over these things. Take life easy. Have a clarity of mind. Be prepared on the spiritual path. There's a great power inside us. With that powerhouse, we go through life with great joy, jumping around. Nothing stops us from that. We don't have any fear left. We have no doubt left. The most depressing things in life are fear and doubt. And excessive reliance on mind generates both of them. Let's live more with the spirit and less with the mind. Use the mind to work for you when you need it. Do not let the mind make decisions for you. Lead a life of the three yogas. Act with great skill and to the best of your ability to perform the role set for you. Go by the script. Don't mess up the play by departing from the script. Do it very well. But remember, it's just a script. It's just a play. This whole world is just a play, and we are playing our part according to a pre-written script. Don't depart from it. But remember that all knowledge that we get, all the books that we read, are intended to show our deficiency. They don't show what we can do, they show what we cannot do. When you have read all the books, you find the books have given you nothing. One man came to the great master. He said, "Master, I don't understand these things." He says, "Read the books." He says, "Where?" He says, "My library is full of books." He sent him to his library, and there were 1,000 books. The man kept on reading. Another man came and said, "I have read all the books in my library. What should I do next?" He says, "Go and dump them in the sea." He said, "They have served their purpose. You found out they contain nothing." So he gave different advice to different people who were in different stages of development. If you read, if you only read and not practice,
The books are of no use. You can keep on reading, keep on reading. In Guru Granth Sahib, the holy book of the Sikhs, there is a line which says, if you read the books and the scriptures day after day, if you read them with every breath of your life, if you read them year after year, if you read them the whole life, it's a total waste of time. The only effect is a bloated ego that you have done so much and you get nothing spiritually. It's a very bold statement for a spiritual book to make. That you only add to your ego, I have read so much. And people compete with each other. Two people, learned people meet, and one thinks one can get some knowledge from them. All you find is they dispute. No, that comma was not there. That comma was there. This meant this. The same words they are interpreting differently, and none of them know. You sit and smile. Are these learned people? These people have so much of this memory packed with all these words. What have they got out of it? Their ego, their personal life, their anger is so strong. You say some little thing to provoke them, they burst out with anger. Their face blazes out. Their energy of concentration is disappearing. You can see it going out. People who see halos, they see a man in anger, the halo, the orange-red colors going out like this, flying out. What is it? It's all the anger flying out. What can that man get? And you find these people full of lust. They see their tension going down. They cannot control it. You find these people attached to things. They're greedy. And you are talking to them something else. Their eyes on your wallet, on your notebook. With a sharp eye, you can see all that's going on. And yet these people are called learned because they read many books. Has books helped them? Books has only bloated their ego. And none of these vices has gone away from them. Therefore, stay on simple meditation that gives you clarity, that gives you control, that keeps the mind and senses in your control and not that they control you. So you be in control because you are supposed to be in control. You are consciousness. You are the motive power that makes these things work. How can you allow them to control you? So with meditation at the third eye center, you will get a lot of control and you will get humility of a different kind. Not the humility of ego. I am humble. Why? Because I know how to say I am humble. That's no humility. True humility is, I know nothing my master alone knows. I do nothing but my master does everything. And not to say it to people, say it to yourself. Feel it yourself. True humility will come inside you. So the humility comes by practice. Nothing comes without practice.